Hey Minions, welcome to Crank It Up's special video for Smash Up's 10th anniversary. I hope that you enjoyed that special look back at Smash Up throughout the years. Today you'll be mostly hearing from the community as they were given the choice to talk about whatever they wanted. This, to me, is the best way to celebrate the game's milestone by letting the community that defines it speak its mind. We had many people who wanted to participate but ultimately couldn't, and I wish we could have had more, but I want to thank all the people who were part of today's video. Of course, I also promised that I would reveal the winners of our community custom faction month, which I will do, in snippets throughout this very long video. I ended up taking 6 entries, and with the spot that I've reserved for the 7th, that will carry us from mid-November to the end of the year. The submissions were great, and this was really hard, and some very deserving factions got left out, which is unfortunate. I wish I could highlight more, but it is a competition, and I want to honor those who truly blew me away. The soft theme was back to basics, which is funny, because some were, and some definitely weren't, but there were a lot of factors that went into this. How well did you adhere to the bandit rules? Did you pass the 5-card identity test? If I could pick out your double features, that's a big plus. Did my blind interpretation of your faction match your description that you provided? Did it inspire me? Did it stick out in my mind? Did I want to hijack your design space and tinker with it myself? I even got to play many of them, to see for myself how they worked. There were a lot of criteria, and not everyone met everything, but I really liked these 6 and wanted to play in those worlds. It was more about creativity and not necessarily strength, because balance can be in the eye of the beholder, and let's be honest, no custom is truly that playtested. I will be revealing them throughout each segment in no particular order other than what makes narrative sense to me. Remember that this was anonymous, and in some cases I was surprised by who the author ended up being. There were a lot of recurring themes throughout the submissions, and many of them had hybrid abilities, but this first faction was very simple in its premise and execution, and that is the Sphinxes from Lord Mewtwo. The Sphinxes introduce an aspect of mind games and force interactions through choice. I love these types of factions because they put each player in the position of the other, and naturally, they want to get the better end of the deal. They also have aspects of elves in them, which you know I'm going to love. Now, I'll turn it over to Corny Kev to kick us off with this video.
Hello, I'm Corny Kev. You may remember me from my recent appearance on the day of Smashing 2, the second one, where I defeated Bandit's Marmounties with the star-roaming Magical Girls. Or maybe you remember me from the first day of Smashing, where I defeated Bandit's Goblin Pirates with shape-shifting Knights of the Round Table. But today, I will not be Smashing. I'm here to talk about the Grannies. Since the release in early 2017, Grannies have been a baffling choice for Smash Up players. In terms of choice, why Grannies? Where are the grandpas? Where did Granny get her gun? And why does the matriarch have a picture of the Count displayed in her home? In terms of design, they're technically a support faction, in the sense that factions like Wizards or Time Travelers are support factions. This means they provide card draw or sifting, recursion, and extra plays for their partner to use. However, unlike Wizards or Time Travelers, the support Grannies provide requires you to lean heavily into their game plan. The Grannies, of course, are all about card sorting. They like their actions to be on the top of the deck, and the minions to be on the bottom. Failure to do this, which is very possible even with the Grannies' own cards, results in whiffed plays and useful minions banished to the bottom of your deck. Their need to arrange the deck in such a bizarre way for such little payoff has been understandably off-putting for players. The reward for playing them as intended does not, by any stretch, outweigh the difficulty in playing them at all. So, for the last 5 years, Grannies have found themselves among the lowest-ranked factions, often adjacent to vampires. It's a fair comparison, because Grannies, like vampires, have been a support faction in the sense that, if you choose to play with them, you're hoping to mainly draw their partner's cards and the small handful of decent cards that they themselves provide. With Grannies receiving a Titan for the 10th anniversary, I wanted to look back at some viable Grannies combos up to this point. Their niche of drawing and playing actions from the top of your deck and minions from the bottom is a highly specific one, but there have been partners who either made good use of it, or were so desperate for some form of draw and recursion that they didn't care what it looked like. Bandit has already mentioned aliens in his video on Great-Grandma, but I'll look at another Corset faction. Dinosaurs, at least pre-Titan, appreciate the Granny's contrived draw and don't mind bottom-decking some of their own cards in order to do so. Not to mention they have always room at Granny's and Chicken Soup to procure King Rex at least one or two times. With the release of the first Titan kit, Granny Ghosts became an interesting option for players who wanted to try and take advantage of Cream Puff Man. Cream Puff Man's talent, of course, lets him bottom deck whatever action he plays from the discard pile, and then Matriarch can immediately put it back in the discard pile with her talent. In my experience, the action in question is usually Shady Deal. Then you have classics such as Innsmouth Grannies, Mad Scientist Grannies, and Mythic Greek Grannies. Bandit has already discussed all three of these in detail, but there's a Granny's combo I really enjoy that I don't see talked about much, and that's Kaiju Grannies. Kaiju provide a wealth of extra power via actions, and Grannies give Kaiju five additional ways to play those actions. The chances of Nana revealing or playing an action have never been better. That said, the advent of Great-Grandma opens up a ton of additional partners for Grannies and recontextualizes a few of their own cards, namely all of their minions and Attic Treasures. Bandit has already discussed Great-Grandma's deceptively powerful ongoing ability in his Calling All Titans video, but I will just take a moment to say that, with the Titan, Attic Treasures more or less becomes queue up your next 2 to 3 turns worth of extra minion plays on the bottom of your deck. Draw 3 cards. With Great-Grandma, each combo that's already been mentioned only gets better. I played Granny Dinosaurs and Granny Ghosts without their partner Titans, and both have proved effective. Even Super Spy Grannies, which is notorious for its ability to sift through your deck and not much else, gets a major buff with Great-Grandma providing +1 power for playing 17 out of the 20 minions, and usually 2 in a turn. Any faction with strong minions of power 3 or less is going to appreciate Grannies now, and I will briefly cover some pairing options that I have discovered since Bandit's video on Great-Grandma a few months ago. Mages provide both Happy Zappers and Wand Whizzes. Wand Whiz, in particular, can start some huge plays when played from the bottom of your deck as a free minion. Magical Girls have 7 viable choices for minions of power 3 or less, as well as extra minion plays and recursion to complement the Grannies. Miskatonic University's Field Trip suddenly becomes a lot more useful when you can load up the bottom of your deck with 2 and 3 power minions in exchange for card draw, much like Attic Treasures. Big Hero 6 deserves a special shout-out for featuring only minions of power 3 or less, and Grannies give Big Hero 6 the extra plays and recursion for both minions and actions that they need. Hydro Grannies can reliably pull off big plays that involve turning your agents into a mishmash of Zolas and 3 power Grandmas, and both factions have enough recursion to do this repeatedly. Grannies give S.H.I.E.L.D. more reliable recursion than Rescue Mission in the form of Always Room at Grannies and Chicken Soup, as well as chances to play their terminal actions like Work Together or Mission Debriefing as extra actions with Nana. Masters of Evil Grannies can play multiple Absorbing Men in a turn with ease, and more frequently get to Zima with Family Reunion, Matriarch, and Hush My Stories Are On. Granny Avengers, while clumsy in some sense, as Avengers don't have any 3 power minions, don't mind strategize bottom decking minions and have always room at Granny's and Chicken Soup to grab Avengers for more immediate replayability. Granny Kree act as a variation of Mythic Greek Grannies, with Granny's Purse and Nana getting extra mileage out of proven methods. Grannies like the movement and power boosts ultimates provide, and especially appreciate Cosmic Knowledge as a more flexible Attic Treasures, like Field Trip. Sinister Six Grannies can drop a lot of breakpoint damage out of nowhere, with 2 power minions that are functionally 4 power, and 2 copies of Green Goblin, who is more or less a 6 power drop that can be played for free from the bottom of your deck. And Spider-Verse likes the extra push that Grannies can give them during Phase 2 with the extra minion plays, while also providing their own means of bottom decking cards and the ability to push during Phase 3. And, if you were paying attention, you likely noticed that I just went through all 8 Marvel factions. I'll stop there for now. But I will add that Great-Grandma has made me excited to play as Grannies, and I think that this is absolutely the competitive shot in the arm they've been needing for so long.
For the next winner, the submission was based on a concept that I absolutely love, that Smashup refuses to embrace, and that is hand size. The Hibernators from Adam Eisbrenner not only increase hand size, but incentivize you for having more cards. You may remember Adam from The Fisherman of last time, and I was pleasantly shocked to find out who had submitted it. They have a really interesting leader who ties into the faction concept in multiple ways, and I think you will enjoy learning more about them. Moving right along, I'll turn it over to Chucky, Blackjack, and Sonus.
Hi, welcome everybody. I'm Chucky, and I'm joined here today by Jack.
Hey there.
And Sonus.
Hey everyone.
Yeah, all of us are obviously very happy to be here for the 10th anniversary, so Bandit, right from the get-go, thanks a lot for having us. What we are aiming to do here is to have a brief discussion about the development of power creep in the history of SmashUp. Since, well, the core set came out 10 years ago, we thought it'd be interesting to look at how the overall power level of the game developed, how well the old factions sold up nowadays, how much maybe newer factions are generally more powerful or not than the old ones, and if whatever development is healthy for the game, or if it's a bad thing or a problem. One thing to maybe get out of the way first, we are talking on faction basis purely. That is to say, we are not comparing if card X is better or weaker than card Y individually, but only factions as a whole. Yeah, I think to start out, it might be a good idea to just look at what did SmashUp look like early on, which factions were very good at the time, and yeah, just look how well these sold up nowadays. Sonus, do you have any examples you'd like to give?
Yeah, for sure. So yeah, I started playing when the game very first came out, so there's definitely been some changes. It's harder to remember, like, just with the first and second set only, but if you go up to, like, science fiction from the base set, things like spies, at least for us, especially in three-player, we ranked them a lot higher back then than we do now. We were using spies a lot. It seemed like they were always winning. Ninjas, we were like, wow, these are way better than we keep thinking they are, which is something I don't think held up as well as it did back then. And then there's, of course, the factions that weren't useful and still never were, like Tricksters. Even back then, they didn't work. Even when there was less to use, they just really flopped. Spies are my most notable, though, of a faction that I still think's good, but that was really good back then. I guess Elder Things is another example. We were like, we're pretty sure they're as strong as robots and zombies. And then more and more sets came out, and they've just, for us, gone down and down. So those are some of my big examples.
I think especially looking at the core set, the strength of these factions here are all over the place. I mean, we have robots and zombies were all-time favorites in terms of strength. And as Sona said, also Tricksters, who can't really hold against these. I mean, it makes sense. We were trying to figure out what works and what doesn't, and it was first set. After that, I think it got a lot more streamlined.
Yeah, I for sure agree on that. That is something I would have gotten into later, probably. But one thing that is important to take into account is that the core set wasn't even that balanced to begin with, at least looking from it from today's perspective. I think when we all started playing, we also didn't play as well or didn't know as much about the factions as we do nowadays. But for sure, I mean, we can all agree that robots and zombies were way better than the rest of the set, and also these two for sure are still among the very top tier.
And all players I came across, every time a new player, they immediately noticed how good zombies and robots were, and then later figure out how good wizards were and stuff. But yeah, zombies and robots were always a stick out for basically anyone I ever met that started playing.
So moving into the newer factions, I would say from my perspective that for sure the average level of factions is higher than it was back then.
At what point do you think that started?
That's a good question, to be honest. Like, when I think of, so to say, modern factions, I start thinking about that, about It's Your Fault time, probably.
I put it at pretty personally.
All right. For me, it would rather be It's Your Fault. And then there is yet another break with, like, World Tour. Probably. I think one trend is that newer factions are a bit more well-rounded. Like, there was more effort put into giving each faction a bit of card draw. That's the thing about older factions. They tend to, or a lot of them tend to not draw as much or as good on their own. And, like, more factions have a bit of recursion and the likes and do depend less on the partner than earlier factions did, and I think the World Tour sets and then the two licensed ones. So Marvel and Disney took that to yet another level, in my opinion, to some degree.
I would agree with that. I think when I look back to Monster Smash, the expansion, there are lots of factions that don't really hold up to the strength-wise. Pretty Pretty is already pretty good after that, and then Munchkins has a couple of exceptions again. So I think starting with It's Your Fault gets consistently better.
I'd agree with that.
Yeah, that would make and the Titans that came out make that make sense too, I'd say, with Monster Smash getting three initially.
Right.
Yeah. But that is also where I would say that the average level for sure was raised, because like you mentioned spice and the likes, and I think over time you generally notice weaker factions fall off a bit more. Like for example, Bear Cavalry without Titan for sure is bad as of now. And they weren't super competitive compared to robots and zombies back then, but they were more playable, I would say. Or also stuff like clans and the likes were pretty good at the time, and now you would rather, without Titan, we have to say nowadays about clans, but basic clans would be written way higher regard around the time Cthulhu came out, science fiction came out, than we would say after like Marvel came out, for example.
Well, I think there's some examples of the opposite too, like I didn't think pirates were good for a while, and over time they've gotten more and more good partners. Like when Power Counters came out, you know, like Mad Scientist, Giant Ants, and then just more and more keep being added. Russian Fairy Tales are good with them, just another. So that's an opposite example of a faction that wasn't good, at least to us, and has gotten better just with better partners coming out.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's a great point in my opinion, because there is the thing that you can say that a faction that came out kind of replaces an older faction. For example, some people said that about Ultimates, basically rendering some of the older movement factions more useless because you could always pick Ultimates. At the same time, you have to think about how newer factions are maybe better partners for older factions. I think, for example, movement factions as a whole are a lot more viable because you have better partners nowadays.
Especially in the newest sets, we have lots of movement. You were talking about it. Mermaids focus on movement. We have the Disney edition. There's a bit, to be honest, Knights of the Round Table, Ultimates, and so on and so forth. So every set and pretty much every promo faction as well has a movement package.
Yeah, Knights are also a great example of modern faction that is really, really strong. In my opinion, like, I think we all agree that they are at a strong level compared to Smash Up as a whole. Not broken, but in my opinion, very strong. And yeah. So to get that, maybe just lay that down as a foundation once more, I think we all agree that there is a bit of power creep in Smash Up compared to all the factions, right?
Yes.
Yeah, but I guess what's our definition here of power creep? I'm used to it meaning replaces, saying use this because it's better than that other faction at doing the same thing. I'm not so sure that's happened.
For me, that's happened especially with the Smash Up Marvel expansion. Again, that makes kind of sense because it was meant to give players a new start, kind of like the Smash Up 2.0, with a lot of beginner factions. We have Avengers pretty much covering the superheroes. Shield is your, normal spam faction. Ultimates have the movement package. Spider-Verse replacing ninjas.
I'm not so sure about the replace in that point. I feel like the factions, if they were replaced, it's because they weren't good to begin with. Would probably be my only thing. Like, if ninjas just weren't good and being picked at all, then yeah, Spider-Verse fills that slot they were supposed to fill. But
yeah.
I'm not so sure anyone got kicked out by a new faction and that faction was being used regularly.
I have something to add to both of that, or at least together for me, because number one is that besides direct replacements, I think one thing to take into consideration for power creep is also the general power level of all factions. So even if the superheroes for me are a faction that is not really directly replaced, there isn't any faction that does precisely what they do. However, they were a lot stronger at their time, just because the competition was always weaker, and as I said, the overall level is for sure better, in my opinion. Therefore, these factions in comparison are weaker. So if I now look at a random draft out of 8 factions, it's for sure harder to pick one of these factions and win. So besides direct replacement, the overall comparison level is something to take into account, in my opinion.
Yeah, I don't think that a new tier was created because of new factions, if I put it that way. I just think more factions came out at a higher level in general, but no new tier was created due to new factions.
Yeah, and that's precisely the second point I wanted to get at, that in a way the strong power level, in my opinion, was always there with like robots and zombies and wizards, and stronger factions came close to that level, but not really above that, in my opinion. And it's rather that a faction like Bear Cavalry or whatever was actually weak back then. You only notice it more nowadays because the overall level is more consistent. But I wouldn't say that we necessarily raised the roof. There are some things that get close with like Innsmouth Titan or Ghost Titan, but I think overall the very top level has not actually been broken, in my opinion.
Would agree with that, yeah.
Yeah, I agree.
I think
too.
We reached this, Innsmouth and Ghost Titan, certainly as strong as robots or zombies. There's two to every combo I can play. There's a counter or at least an as powerful combo against it.
Maybe that is a good segue into discussing Titans more generally. We're talking a lot on factions, new factions from expansions. How would you rate the impact of the first Titan set, first and foremost? Because that's an interesting question to ask for power creep. On one hand, you could say that it made some factions more viable yet again. On the opposite side, you could make the argument that it did also contribute to raising the bar even higher, how strong a faction has to be viable.
I don't think it raised the bar for how strong a faction has to be. I really think it just moved more factions up to the level that already existed. Because there's still factions that didn't get a Titan that are just as strong or stronger than the ones that did. So I don't know. So they could have always been that bar, even if no new Titans came out.
I think it's kind of similar to the core set, that we were trying out new things and didn't really getting it right at the start. And some Titans were too strong for the factions they were supposed to buff, like the Ghost Titans. And I think some factions as a whole made an insane jump in power level. And others at too little going on for them. I mean, as a whole, you can say that the Titans are a power creep, a form of power creep in its in most pure state, because an already existing faction just got better.
Yeah, but as you said, I would also say that generally it only helped, in my opinion, more factions be viable at some level again. For some, it could have done more. And yeah, maybe actually Innsmouth and Ghosts are the only two factions that I would maybe say power crept the game too much or went further than we should go in terms of power level.
Well, and I think one thing they did was make it so new factions actually had to be less strong because they could be exploited by new Ghosts and new Innsmouth and stuff like that. Werewolf
also,
Titan's a huge example.
Everlasting bane of how strong a talent can be.
Yeah.
But I would like to ask the same question yet again back to sets of expansions. If you look at the two most recently released expansions, Disney and Marvel, would you say that power level is a good one, that these factions should be as strong as they are? Or would you, for example, say, oh my, Kree are so much better than Greeks or Musketeers. Shield are so much better in minion spam. The Disney factions are all so strong. They probably shouldn't be as good. What is your opinion on that?
I think for me to answer that, I'd need to like give a brief definition of how I do tier lists. So if I'm saying SS is the stuff that's by far the best, like zombies and robots, and then below that's S, and then A, and then of course the very bottom might be like grannies and D tier or something. I would want, like in that definition of letters, I'd want things to be in A tier. So just S and SS are above that. I think Marvel mostly fell into A, or and then there's one or two that might have gone to S, and one or two that might have gone to B. So I don't think that it, like, if they all fell into my version of what S would be, that would have been a problem. I just don't think that happened. And I don't think that happened with Disney either, but I think they're all, for the most part, on the higher end of A, if not in S, with maybe Frozen being close to what's unacceptable for sure.
Can you, for reference, name one or two older factions and how you would put those into S or A, just so the listeners have an idea of what your own power perception is?
Yeah, so like I was saying, like zombies and robots, I still have in the SS, which is obviously not a good level to be at for the game. S, something like wizards, Greeks, Grimms, dragons, Hydra. That's where I'd some S. And then maybe for some A, that's where I'm putting like Avengers, Incas, Apes, Mages, which is the level I think is the right level.
How's that for you, Blackjack? What level do you consider good or reasonable, and how do these newer sets line up to that, in your opinion?
I think I see that very similar to Zonas, actually. I would add that for Marvel, at least, I think we are hitting the A tier for most of these factions, but it was also very easy to set the factions up because they are so beginner-friendly, as I said earlier, and they don't have such complicated or complex themes. For Disney, I would say the factions are a bit more complicated, and it's a lot harder to see all the different partners and see all the different potential each faction has. For example, Aladdin with this wish cards, or Big Hero 6, the power counters. I think these factions individually are okay and are probably in the A tier, but with certain partner factions, they can become easily double S.
I would agree with that, with both of your assessments, probably, and I also agree personally that around A level, A plus, low S, whatever is the level I personally would like to aim new factions at, because get back to the beginning, we had those power levels out there right from the start. Like you start in a set that has robots, zombies, and then a bunch that is weak, like tricksters and some in betweens. And then throughout these sets, they have always been strong factions. Like we got Mythic Horses, we got Greeks, later we got Rockstars, to name a few that are very strong individual factions that still hold up extremely well, in my opinion. And I think once you have these power levels out there, you can have the debate if it's better to go up to that level, release new stuff that can compete and buff some older ones with Titans, or if you maybe should try to aim for a lower level so that you have that tier that more factions are on and some that are higher, but these are kind of in the minority. And I personally prefer to aim a bit on the stronger side, even that out, because yeah, some of the older factions maybe weren't all that good to begin with, and it's not that they were outclassed later on, but only more apparent, so that power level more consistent. However, of course, that nerf down, buff up is a whole other subject of discussion that I think we can't cover in the time given by Bandit, which we are also slowly running out, so I kind of already give my synopsis, I think my own personal conclusion with that. Is there anything left that the two of you would like to say as a final word from your side?
For power creep, we can agree that the factions are a bit stronger, a bit more consistent in their power level as they were in the earlier sets, but that is of course also a good thing, because here we have more balanced games. I think that we didn't say that we strive to have the most balanced games between opponents and to actually come to a game with a certain amount of playtime, right? You don't want to be you don't want to have a game that's over in 5 minutes. So yeah, to reach that, the A tier is, in my opinion, the best tier.
Yeah, I think I'd say something like, as far as Disney and Marvel go, just at the end, I think what they did was infuse the game with 16 or so more factions that all fell in around A, which when that all comes in at the same time really shakes things up, but it doesn't necessarily mean they came out better than everything else. It was just so many new things at once that you could start using for good balanced games.
All right. Then I think we have nothing left to say but happy 10th anniversary Smash Up. As a game, thanks a lot to Bandit for organizing this whole stream, everything else you do for the game, keeping it alive. Yeah, definitely a game that we have put quite a lot of time in, starting out early. So yeah, great to be a part of this and give our own 2 cents to that discussion. Also, thank you to everyone else we met with or through Smash Up, to Paul, to Brian, everyone else from the community. And yeah, just shout out to the Smash Up community as a whole. It's great to have such lovely online discussion place with total strangers. A lot of people there. Yeah, just playing the game, keeping it alive, and yeah, happy 10th anniversary, I'd say.
For the next winner, the idea was absolutely insane, and if I'm really being honest, I didn't think it was going to work, and I had to try it myself, and that's Ferngully from Ludicrousness. It's really hard to distill Ferngully into a single card, but they repurpose both cards and power counters, and use the transfer of power counters to alternate between good and bad effects. Most notably, they can embed standard actions to be played later. What struck me most about this was how it did not feel like a gimmick at all. It was hard to do, and an alternative to burying, and it felt earned. It gives you a deferred extra play to work toward, while also letting you use standard actions differently, avoiding their cast problems as they are often terminal. Having played them with a base modifier faction, I can say that it really doesn't play like a base modifier faction, and I love that. Moving on to the next segment, I want to welcome back Beryl to refute everything Sonus just said.
Hey all, I'm Beryl, back again, hot off my second victory over Bandit in the day of Smashing 2, the second one. Now that we're 10 years into the lifespan of Smash Up, it's no secret that some of the older factions are starting to show their age. From old conventions leading to crazy knots in the rules, to head-scratching card designs on both ends of the strength scale, Smash Up's first few sets seem haphazardly put together compared to some more modern releases. The direction the game took to try and solve some of their past mistakes led to some of the most anticipated content in the 10th anniversary set, the 11 new optional Titans. While trying to guess which factions were lucky enough to receive one was a fun activity a few months ago, we now have to start coming to terms with a rising problem that's the result of bumping new factions up this way, Titanflation. When so many factions have a card they always have access to, if other factions don't have a way to deal with it, then they're going to be at a distinct disadvantage. Looking at the current compendy of now 95 factions, 32 of them have Titans, 5 native Titans from Big in Japan and Penguins, 16 from the Titan Event Kit, and now 11 from the 10th. In contrast, only 9 factions have non-Titan cards that can interact with other players' Titans in any way, 4 of which have Titans themselves. Even the geeks, who are known for messing with other players' cards, cannot interact with Titans directly unless you count stealing a native Titan with min-maxing. It's become apparent over time that Titans may not have been the right way to fix weaker factions, but that begs the question, how else could the game have done it? What seems to be the most popular answer, and the one I'll be talking about, is simply rewriting cards. Making just a few well-targeted tweaks could go a long way in boosting certain factions. This has several advantages over stapling a Titan onto a bad faction. First and foremost, the scope is much broader. Rewriting cards can work both ways, lifting weaker factions up and toning overly strong factions down. With Titans, we can attempt to fix our past mistakes in the lower end, but nothing can be done about old factions in the high end, like robots, aliens, and geeks. Those strong factions stay strong, and all we can do about it is wonder what could have been. Rewrites also have a larger horizontal scope, not just vertical scope. With the only changes being text on cards, I would at least presume printing the cards gets a lot cheaper, meaning many more factions can be targeted for balance instead of a select few receiving a bump. If a booster pack with all the rewritten cards were sold instead of the Titan Event Kit, it would stand a chance of not only being cheaper for everybody involved, but more accessible for players trying to dip their toes into the extended compendium without introducing the complicated rules that come along with Titans. A second advantage card rewrites have is the flexibility to look at individual cases. With Titans, you have one card to fix all a faction's problems, and with the game's insistence on the 2-box rule, there's very limited space for what can be done. If the faction can't be solved by just stapling on 2 abilities and an entry criteria, then it's just out of luck. With card rewrites, you can look more closely at a faction's issues, figure out what went wrong and how to fix it, and adjust as many cards as you need to solve those issues, no more and no fewer. Third and finally, it helps keep the game's metrics in check, making things more fun for everybody. There's been a trend recently of games becoming shorter and more powerful, and as a result, many older, slower factions that were perfectly fine before suddenly need a Titan to keep up. Think of things like Fort Titanosaurus and Category 5. This arms race inevitably leads to higher variance, where whoever can take advantage of their free boost the best wins by default, which is a lot less fun. If, instead of strictly adding things on, we made changes to what already existed with the goal of making cohesive but balanced factions, then the arms race stops, as the playing field starts being leveled instead of being staggered even more based on who got a Titan. To keep with the theme of this event, we'll take a closer look and apply this to the Killer Plants, a faction that received a Titan in the 10th, and one of the stronger ones at that. The strength of the Kudzu implies that the Killer Plants need a complete overhaul to make up for design shortcomings, but is this really the case? Before we discuss what exactly is getting tweaked, we need to start with some of the questions Bandit asks in every Calling All Titans video. What went wrong with the original faction, and what does the faction need? Bandit gave his thoughts about the Killer Kudzu, but I want to offer my own, slightly different perspective, because pre-Titan, Plants were still my number two favorite faction, and if you know me, the number one should be obvious. Perhaps their biggest issue is their complete lack of internal synergy. You have four Sprouts who tell you they want to grab Water Lilies. Water Lilies only want one copy out at a time, which goes directly against the commonality of Sprouts, and on top of that, as a search faction, direct card draw is less valuable to them. The only thing Venus Mantrap can grab is Sprout, who makes no sense in a burst context since they want to wait a turn and grab something else. Weed Eater doesn't fit in anywhere, being counterproductive in a burst and not being searchable by the other minions. They have two copies of Instagrow, which in other contexts is a great card, but none of their cards particularly care about being in a burst. Typically, Instagrow is used to play a part minion or to set up, usually both. Sleep Spores and Choking Vines make no sense from a resource perspective, since Plants burn through their minions way too quickly to be able to afford permanent power suppression and destruction. Blossom, despite being an incredible card, has no internal targets for similar reasons to Venus Mantrap. Budding seems best suited to grab your elites, but the Plants elite is terrible. Deep Roots and Entangled both only make sense in an awesome level 9000 context, where berries were perceived as much more of a threat than they really are. Too much weight is placed on Overgrowth, and while I love that card to death, it's extremely problematic for any interaction at the start of your turn. Their other major issue is their minion starvation. Searching for your minions is great until you don't have any more on your deck and your sprout goes into nothing. You often run out of minions to play late in the game, and Plants by themselves don't have enough draw power, direct or indirect, to easily reach a reshuffle. Credit where it's due, this is the one problem the Kudzu addresses, but without the Titan, you definitely feel this pain. Even just one way to shuffle back your minions in their cards would have gone a long way toward making the Kudzu unnecessary. So, what do Plants really need? In short, they need flow. Having a natural progression for which cards can play or search would go a very long way toward giving them internal synergy. Additionally, they do need at least one source of recursion to the deck, because that is a legitimate problem, not just a built-in weakness they can overcome. It's not like Shapeshifters where the quantity of cards that self-destruct and search is small enough that you can manage without recursion. Six of their cards, including half of their minions, rely on having other minions in your deck to do anything. So, how could we tweak the Plants to solve their issues? The number one place to start is Weed Eater, who, as mentioned, gets the short end of the stick in just about every way. My idea to fix it is the following. Make it a 2-power minion that cancels its abilities until the start of your turn, with an ongoing that gives it +3 power. Even this change alone solves many of their internal issues. Without changing the eventual size of the minion, both Sprout and Venus Mantrap have 2 more minions they can grab. It becomes easier to play Weed Eaters with Instagrow, or even Blossom, since their footprint stays smaller for longer. You would actually want to play Budding to grab your second Weed Eater, since they're now worth playing normally. It doesn't solve all their issues, but even just one small change, one that barely even affects what the card does on its own, massively opens up the deck. For other small tweaks to help with the other issues, the esoteric Entangled could be replaced with mass recursion of minions of power 3 or less, which is convenient with the new Weed Eater, and the problematic overgrowth could be replaced with something that still feels like the plants are overgrowing the area, but still addresses what they need, continually playing small minions from your discard pile. Internally, they will now have ways of recurring every minion except Venus Mantrap, allowing them to use their minions much more liberally, knowing they can get them back much more easily. Even with these simple changes to just 4 of their 20 cards, the plant's identity as a minion search and swarm support faction becomes much more well-defined, with at least an attempt at solving both of their major issues. Compare this with what we got from the Killer Kudzu, a very strong, gimmicky way of addressing their minion starvation and not much else. Weed Eater still sucks, and Overgrowth still does way too much, and it looks like those will never change. Some people may think that doing retrospectives like this, wondering what could have been if things went differently, are a waste of time. After all, Titans and Titanflation are here to stay, and the probability of card changes are slim to none. However, I believe it's important that we not only learn from the mistakes of the past, but come up with our own solutions to them, even if those solutions are purely hypothetical. I hope that this game lasts at least another 10 years, and part of that is going to involve learning how things went wrong and how they could have been fixed, because that, more than many other things, will help prevent the same mistakes from being repeated in the future. Happy 10th anniversary, everybody!
My next selection was one that I thought I was going to hate. I never thought about doing this mechanic, and when I started to think about it, I wondered if it is something that could even work in a smash-up context, and that is the Psychics from Andrew Tucker. Choosing this faction is somewhat ironic, as I have no idea who this person is, but the Psychics really grabbed my attention because I needed to see if it could work, and I feel like it can. The Psychics focus on having bad abilities that they want to cancel, with an indication of what will happen if they do, and it didn't feel like a gimmick, as their inverted minion structure forces you to play the higher ones early, like werewolves. As I played them, it reminded me of Absolute Zero from Sentinels of the Multiverse, who used to be one of my favorite characters in that game, and I think that this is the type of off-the-walls idea that I wanted to feature in a contest of creativity. Now I'll turn it over to Ludacrisness for his segment.
Hey, fellow minions. Ludacrisness here. You might remember me from such films as Custom Faction Designer Panel and that blowout match in Day of Smashing 2, the second one, where I got demolished. I hope you're enjoying the 10th anniversary event that Bandit's putting on, and if you're currently cranking it up, please continue doing so. If you're not, please commence cranking in an upwards direction. When Bandit asked me to participate in this event, I wasn't quite sure what I wanted to discuss, since the topic that I'm most passionate about, custom factions, just had a whole video with Beryl and Lonan and even myself to cover it in exhausting detail. Instead, I wanted to take some time to talk about a tangentially related topic, which is what goes into making a good base card. With respect to custom factions, the majority of them just don't include bases. This is understandable. I didn't include them myself in my first few factions, but I think it's ultimately a pretty missed opportunity to flesh out the custom faction, to make it feel like a more cohesive part of the game, to explore the theme in different ways. If you do plan to play with your custom faction, it'll be really noticeable in a two-player game if one of the factions doesn't bring any bases with it. I think not making bases for a custom faction also indirectly contributes to house rules about base deck construction, because you'll otherwise have significantly fewer bases in the game. So if it's a good idea to have bases for your custom faction, how do you make a good base? I think there's actually a lot of really interesting aspects to a base's design. A minion usually has an interplay between its power and its ability. A base, on the other hand, has an interplay between its breakpoint, its VP awards, and its ability, so increasing the number of variables. You can do some really cool things with base design. As a simple example, you could have a play on base action in a custom faction which rewards you for winning the base, like Happily Ever After. But if that's the dynamic that you want to create with a base, just make the first place VP award higher by one, and then you have the breakpoint and the ability in addition to that that you can manipulate. There's a lot of really intriguing potential in base design, potential which unfortunately, in my opinion, Smash Up mostly wastes. There's several common bad base structures that we see all the time in the real game. There's the neutral base, which is a base close to the 20 breakpoint average, a 4-2-1 VP award standard with a totally neutral and inoffensive ability. There's a base like Retirement Community that provides a pretty bland experience, all things considered. There's also the first-come, first-served base, which is a base that gives a disproportionate benefit to the first player to get to use it, makes it really luck of the draw who gets the best deal. Some key examples are the Explorer bases, like the Ancient Temple. There's the lopsided mechanic base, a base that disproportionately favors a single faction's mechanic, which can sometimes be pretty insular. The biggest example is bases that favor factions with a base action focus, like the Workshop or the Dump on Sonus. There's also the Don't Bother base, a base where there's really just no reason to compete. These are usually bases with really unfavorable splits that you either don't want to compete on or don't want to commit lots of resources to. These could be things like ninja bases or 3-3-2 bases, where there's really just no point. There's the overly centralizing base, a base that commands everyone's attention and becomes the only base that even matters while it's out, like Rhodes Plaza Mall or the factory. And lastly, there's the random base, which is a base that introduces a huge element of chaos into the game, which is only very few factions could interact with or control or steer in any kind of direction, with the obvious example being Unicrave. So like you can see, there's a lot of different bad kinds of bases that you can make, and any of them can feel really bad when they interplay. I think Bandit's done some really good and interesting videos on some of these bases in the past with the Breakpoint on this channel. I definitely recommend you check it out. But I'd take this opportunity to talk about what, in my opinion, makes for a really interesting and compelling base, which is a good addition to the game. And I have six overall topics to address on this. First, a good base should give you a reason to want to play there. This doesn't always have to be a positive incentive. Maybe you're playing there to stop your rival from getting a benefit, or to make sure you don't miss out, or any number of other incentives. But you should always, you know, at a basic level, have a reason to want to be on that base. If this rule is violated, and you get three bases that violate it at the same time, then you have a game state where no one wants to play anywhere, and that kind of sucks. Second, a good base should add an interesting dynamic into the game. When I think about my favorite bases, they're bases that introduce some element of risk and reward to up the stakes of the game. They could be bases like Fairy Circle, where you want to play there, but the extra action you get could be used for any number of things, like a multi-base attack. If you use it too many times, then the other players will be able to score it more easily against you. Storyteller's Hut is a great example. Using it too often will make it a very efficient win for another player, but an extra action can be really impactful elsewhere. This doesn't always need to be complex game theory, but there should be some kind of risk and reward incentive inherent in a base's design that ties into the natural risk inherent in escalating power creep whenever you add power to a base. Third, a good base should be a nudge for the faction that owns them. And this is kind of controversial, and a lot of people disagree on what's the best approach for this. My feeling's always been that the bases tied to a faction should slightly advantage their strategy, but avoid using any reference to their own personal mechanics. And a good example of this is the Golden Lily. It gives you a card if you have a minion there at the end of your turn, and anyone can use a card draw, no question. But it could arguably mean more for a faction like Musketeers, who wants to set up in hand for a big chain of combo actions. And this ties into the fourth point, which is that a good base should be available and interactive with any faction in the game. Ice Castle could be argued to be an interesting dynamic, but if you don't have movement, then it's worse than a dead base. You couldn't score it even if you wanted to at a loss. And Ice Castle also introduces point number five. A good base should satisfy what I call the multiplied condition. If you remember from the iconic Day of Smashing 2, the second one match, with Bandit against Sonus, he initially stacked the deck with three copies of No Moon. This was a joke, but it does raise an interesting question. If you had to play a game with only copies of No Moon in play, what do you do? Anywhere you play, you're at risk of getting blown to smithereens if another base scores. It encourages a terrible game state, where everyone keeps dogpiling onto the same base to avoid the chance of being destroyed whenever a base breaks. So in my opinion, a good base should make for a good game and a good dynamic if there were only copies of that base out. If you have three copies of Storyteller's Hut, you're going to have an insanely fun game. Everyone can play three extra actions every turn, but the bases will shred and breakpoint down to nothing. If you have three copies of the dump on Sonus in play, then actions on bases will never go to the discard pile. That's toxic at best and can become unplayable at worst. A good base should get better when scaled, not worse. And if it doesn't, then it's too centralizing at even one copy, and it should be changed. If a base can only ever be made once without breaking the game, that's a clear sign of a problem. Lastly, a good base should be really intentional about its VP awards. There seems to be a bit of a trend in recent sets to have more linear spreads, which are 1 point splits between first and second place. These bases often have some additional benefit for the winner, or they're unusually easy to play on and get presents. Individually, they can have really good dynamics and make for interesting play. But when scaled, they mean that it becomes very hard to ever catch up to a leader, barring a solo. Any given win will only get you a 1 point margin. These bases always seem really attractive to add to the game, but they need to be done in moderation, or the game can become a slog. As you can see, there's a lot that goes into base considerations. But I'd like to take a bit of a step back to talk about why bases actually matter. And this is something that doesn't get talked about very much, but this is my soapbox, and I refuse to yield my time. Everyone spends a lot of time talking about faction balance, whether this minion is too strong or that action is too much, but that's only half the equation. Where you play a minion is just as significant as what minion you play, and bases are present in every single game. A faction's bases will regularly show up in games not including that faction, whether you play by the rules as written to use the bases from expansions used in the game, the common variant of using every base in a big stack, a fake base drafting variant, or even pre-constructed base decks, of which we've seen one on this channel, with possibly two more to come. You'll always have bases coming in from factions that aren't being used. If a base is so specific that it only makes sense with the faction involved, and yes, I have seen this, then your game could easily be dragged into a really unfun direction whenever it comes out. Bases exist independent of their faction. Their impact can be much more significant than the faction itself. Aliens are awful. You can always ban them or choose not to play them, but the homeworld could still easily be in the base deck. Field of Honor is much more significant than the Bear Cavalry themselves in its effect in distorting the game. So what can you do for custom factions? Well, don't leave it until an afterthought. Don't phone it in. Don't ignore it. Including bases with your custom faction will really make it feel like a cohesive, whole part of the game. It can give you greater insight into the game itself, as well, as you start to pay more attention to bases. Until I started making bases for my custom factions, for example, I hadn't really internalized the significance of 20 as the average breakpoint, so that the thresholds of 19 for Sinister Six and 21 for Rockstars started to make more sense. Until I tried making a 000 base of my own, and I hope the Bandit shows my 000 base from my custom faction month entry on this slide, I didn't realize the role that a 000 base should play, or how hard it is to do right. Bases are an integral and interesting part of the game that often gets overlooked. We have a great custom faction channel on the Discord, though, and just like we'd love to help you get started with developing custom factions, we'd also love to chat about your favorite bases and what some interesting bases might be to suit your custom factions as well. Hope to see you around, and thanks for listening.
For the fifth selection, this is definite proof that the process was anonymous for two reasons. First, I guessed who made it, and I was wrong. And second, I wouldn't knowingly spend more time with this person. However, unlike the person behind it, the faction did not disappoint me, and it's the Rebels from Kornikev. This is another very simple premise that can be used in a variety of ways, giving power counters exclusively to rival minions. It has destruction potential, waste potential, negative power negation, even bits of come at me. What was really interesting was how the Rebels addressed a potential cast issue and made giving other players power non-terminal but also non-threatening in a power creep perspective. This is a faction I kept wanting to hijack because of how it reminds me of a lot of things while having its own spin, which is a great quality. Now for our final guest segment, I want to welcome Vespert back for his second video on the channel.
Hello everyone, I'm known online as Vespert. I've been a Smasher playtester for almost 7 consecutive years, so I've decided to tell you a bit about the playtesting experience. Just a quick note beforehand, like any playtester, I'm under NDA, a non-disclosure agreement, which means I cannot freely talk about everything that goes on behind the playtest scene, but I still try to be as informative as I can be. So, how do you become a playtester? Well, by answering a demand for Smashup playtesters on BoardGameGeek. Those demands are posted on the forum of the main Smashup page there. They contain all the instructions to follow in order to apply, so I won't go over those. If you want to become a playtester and you see a post there saying they are looking for some, don't hesitate and be quick. The number of available spots can be gone really fast, and that often happens within a day. If you don't have the time, check BoardGameGeek. Some Smashup fans usually relay the information that there's a call for playtesters on social media, such as Reddit, Discord, or the Smash Posting Facebook group. I know I relay the call when I see it. Now, if you and your team have been selected to playtest a future new Smashup set, what happens next? A member of your team, who will have the role of team leader, is given access to the print and play file for the future set. That file must be printed out, of course, and cut down into cards, which should then be sleeved. Once that's done, you're ready to playtest the factions. Usually, the first games you're going to play are to get a feel for them, and after each game, the team writes a report. I'll talk a bit about that later, which is then posted on a private forum by the team leader. An important point is that playtesting is not the same as playing your regular Smashup game. We are not playing to win, we are not playing as if it's a casual moment, we are playing to see how the new factions work, and what would need to be changed if there's any problem. That also implies that players should be allowed to play as optimally as possible. For example, they can change their mind if they make a bad decision, they can point out if they see a better move another player can make, and they should be reminded by other players if they forgot something. All of this is done to test how good or bad the future factions can really be. Also, players shouldn't shy away from cards that seem bad either. If there's a card whose ability seems awful to use, such as Pupox, we'll still have to try and use it before we can actually say whether it's really bad or not. And as it turns out, Pupox is not so bad most of the time. Once the game has ended, the players are expected to give their impressions on the factions and their cards. What worked well, what didn't, what the factions lack, how strong did the factions feel, how fun they were, and so on. All those feedbacks should then be collected and posted on the playtest forum by the team leader. And of course, if there are any rule questions that happen during the game about the new cards or about Smash Up in general, they can be posted on the forum as well, where they will eventually receive an official answer. Oh, and of course, no house rules. So no wacky base deck variants, no revised factions, no custom factions or custom titans, and no fifth player. In addition to the feedbacks, a lot of important information is also collected, such as the time spent on a game, the total number of turns, or which bases were played, which ones scored, or which factions had access to a titan. All of that to make statistics based on all the games played by all the teams in order to evaluate the strength of each faction. After some time, Paul Peterson, the designer, reviews the stats and the player feedbacks and decides on the changes that are needed. Once that's done, a new version of the print and play file is made available to the team leaders, and the whole process starts over, with all the teams playing games with that new version of the factions until another version is made. Throughout the playtesting, we're encouraged to mix the new sets with the existing ones, combining a new faction with an old one, pitting a pair of new factions against a pair of existing ones, and checking the game stats to try mixes of new and existing factions that haven't been tried yet. For teams with enough team members, they are encouraged to play games with different numbers of players as well. And yes, we definitely playtested the Marvel and Disney sets with the normal Smash Up sets during all their playtesting periods, in all sorts of combinations, just like we playtest any new Smash Up sets. This is repeated several times until a certain deadline is reached, at which point the factions are considered finished, and no further major updates can be done. Next, while no new games are needed, the player's involvement still is, because AEG will be preparing the final version of the files to go to press, and they need help proofreading the cards and the rulebook. This is certainly the most tedious task. Any players who volunteers to proofread must check every single file to make sure there are no typos, that the wording on the cards are consistent with the existing wording, that everything is comprehensible, and so on. They can even suggest cards that are to be shown on the back of the box, or suggest names for cards. AEG's graphic designer will then make the changes accordingly, and the players will proofread the new files again, checking if all the changes were taken into account and if there were anything that we missed. And this is repeated again and again until the files are considered done and sent to print. And that's about it. This is just a quick overview of how the process goes from the playtester's point of view. So, should you try and become a playtester one day? If you love Smash Up, have a group of players with whom you can play Smash Up regularly, and want to help make the next Smash Up set as fun and innovative as possible, then yes, try to apply next time there's a call for playtesters, even if it's just to playtest one set. It is still a fantastic opportunity to see how the design process goes, and to give your opinion as a fan. Because while there is one game designer on the cover of the box, it is still a group effort, and players' opinions do matter, and can help stir the set in a direction that will appeal to new players and hardcore fans.
Before I get to the final selection, I did want to make some honorable mentions that made the process very difficult. There are a ton of deserving submissions, and it means that not everyone can make it, so I'll honor who I can quickly. The Avatar faction from Lonan has a really great board presence and has the idea of going for a multi-score or obfuscated target. The Earth Mover in particular is my type of card. I apologize if I get your name wrong, but the Bards from Jared Simonelli had a really intriguing premise because they offer a chance for permanent control, which is rare, and it made me want to like Bards, which I refuse to do. because in every RPG that I can recall, I hate bards. But these bards have an interesting take on the Yellow Demon formula and show why Smash-Up really needs subtypes. The final honorable mention goes to Sir Errant and his film noir. Self-destruction factions are really hard because they require a number of ingredients, but this one has a lot of things going for it, and I found myself wanting to micro-tweak several aspects of it. But we only have one more winner, and for the final entry, we have a mechanic I've long wanted used in a way I never thought to use it. It's a great feeling when you see someone else's work that makes you feel like something I've done I got wrong, and that's the feeling I got from the astronomers from Beryl. It took some time to crack them, but if you can focus in on your deck and mill it appropriately, you get what Granny's should have been all along, what Redacted should probably be. It has that snowball-style feeling, whereas your opponent, you need to play fast or disrupt their deck, because figuring out how to benefit from deck foresight is a lot of fun, can happen multiple times per turn, and I can't wait to show you more of their cards. But this, and all other factions, is a topic for another day. Congrats to all the winners in a great contest, and I've asked Bandit to close us out for this special occasion. 10 years of Smash-Up. 8 years of playing it. 5 years of podcasting it. I've covered everything from leaders in actions to faction reviews, bases, mechanical paradigms, titans, design rules, top tens, you name it. We will have our second custom faction month shortly. We've had 2 March Smashnesses, 2 days of smashing, contests, puzzles, guest speakers, everything. I'm already researching charities for a third day of smashing. So what could I possibly talk about for the 10th anniversary? I struggled with this for several weeks to find that perfect topic to be a capstone of this event, and I still have plenty of topics, some of which others covered, some of which weren't, like the decision not to Errata the Great Talent Killer, but there's one thing I haven't talked about nearly as much, something that is perfect for today, and that is what Smash-Up means to me personally. Through all the videos, the events, the questions answered, the conversations we had, if you take one thing away from all of it, I want it to be this. That I love this game. Never doubt this. For my thoughts to land fully, you need to understand a few things about me. First, I am deeply introspective, always thinking about what I do, what I've done, what I'm going to do, am I having the impact that I want to have in all areas of life, not just crank it up. I think about my life, how it has unfolded, what moments bear particular significance, everything, no matter how big or how small. You also need to understand that there have only been 4 games in my adult life that felt like a true expression of myself, that I would deem worthy of being my favorite game, where on a daily basis, I lived, breathed, and thought about these games. First, it was Settlers of Catan, which led to my master's thesis, providing a new direction for my career, and did so much for me personally. But I don't play it anymore. I can't, really, as making the game programmatically ruined it for me. Then there was Dominion. I was obsessed with Dominion. I still am. It remains pure, elegant, and unbelievably enjoyable. But I don't play it anymore. Because no one will play it with me. The industry goes out of its way to try to prove its obsolescence, much like they do with Catan. I'd spend hours a day playing Dominion on Isotropic, with some unbelievably epic victories, and yet I don't play it anymore. I've done 1 podcasting video on it, and it was about how I didn't like the second edition. And for my current favorite game, well, I'm a little biased, but even if something else legitimately took the top spot, Smash-Up would still hold a special distinction. I still play it, I still discuss it, I still live it. In an industry where games are obsolete a month after retail, where games are developed and purchased faster than you can play them, in an industry that pushes quantity at unprecedented levels while still somehow maintaining a higher degree of quality, where 10x10s are a challenge, in a period of my life where my time is more limited than ever, where I'm just trying to balance being a father, a manager, a designer, and crank it up, when I don't even have a weekly game night anymore, I still play Smash-Up. I still discuss it every day. And it brings up the natural question, why? Why do I focus so much of my time on this singular game? And the answer is deceptively simple, because it's special. If you ask what does Smash-Up mean to me personally, in some respects the answer is more than you can imagine. If I'm really being honest, I think the 10th anniversary box could have been better. A lot better. I'm still not sure how I feel about Disney. I don't think that the last year or two have been particularly good for the game system, but I still want it to be better. I want it to be the best it can. I want new players to discover the same joy that enraptured me all those years ago. Sometimes I wonder, Am I being too harsh? If I change the Ninja Titan to an alternate wording that reflects how I read it, is that me being honest or hurtful? The simple truth is that my time has never been more limited, more valuable than ever before. And if I'm still talking Smash Up, it's because I'm trying to make it better. If I'm still talking Smash Up, it means that I still love it, and I'm still promoting it, and I'm just trying to make it better. When I answer a question and say that a rule is dumb, it's because I want it to be changed, because the game will be better for it, and I have seen rules get changed because we pushed for them. If I didn't think that something could be salvaged, I would just ignore it, like I do with Basie. Why do I fight so hard for this game? Because it's a part of my life. For better or for worse, it's become part of my identity. I'm proud of the things we've accomplished as a community. I'm inspired by the people that I work with. A recurring joke among my friends is that I refused to join the Smash Up Discord for years, because if I did, my productivity would tank. I'd never get anything done. I'd be talking Smash Up even more. And then I finally caved, and yep, productivity tanked. It took 6 months for me to reach the number 5 spot. Just imagine if I joined years ago. I'm actually in 2 Smash Up Discords, and I don't even speak French. But it's a chance for me to connect with fellow players, to see and learn from their perspective, to be amazed from their persistence and intelligence. There are many differences between Catan and Dominion and Smash Up. Catan and Dominion both won the Spiel des Jahres. They came with the pedigree. Catan inspired an entire generation of gamers, brought an entire genre of gaming from Europe to the West. Dominion created a new mechanic that saw countless clones. The industry became obsessed with proving its irrelevance. Dominion is currently 113 on BoardGameGeek. Catan is 470 when it used to be in the 50s. Smash Up is 1024, which is still amazing, all things considered, given the sheer volume of games that are out there. But it lacks the pomp and circumstance of the other games. It lacks the household name brand recognition. It's not even sold in the mass market in my area anymore. And yet, here we are, 10 years later, still selling it, still making it, still talking about it, because it's special. Speaking of being introspective, there are a lot of things that often inspire me that I think on from time to time to keep perspective. I would hope that Crank It Up has been overwhelmingly positive for the game and its community. People and followers will always come and go. It's just the nature of things. But Crank It Up exists to serve, and people tell me that it's made their experience better, and I truly strive for that every single time. But I also remember the first comment Crank It Up ever got, and how it was really kind of negative. It was made in a place where you'd think people would be more supportive, and the gist of the comment was that Smash Up was too small for a dedicated channel, and every follower, every watch, every comment, every expansion proves this person wrong and shows the strength of our community. It shows the reason why this game is still around 10 years later, because of all of you. This isn't a game that is meant to be played once or on occasion, it's a game that can consume you if you let it. It can sustain you and never become dull. For me, it's been a daily process of examining every aspect of this game, looking for every advantage, where it's going, where it's been. And the community proves that this game is worthy of that dedication. A running joke between myself and Sonus is that we review Smash Up reviews to see if they truly get this game. And I gotta be honest, so often they don't. It's amazing that this game has lasted so long without a clear, consistent identity. Many view it as casual and zany, whereas we tend to think of it as deceptively cutthroat and competitive. It's a game system, not just a game. Your first game is input to your next game. It grows, it evolves, it expands, and it survives based on players introducing others to the real game to see what it could be rather than how it started. And I'm so grateful that I got to be part of it in any capacity. I often tell people how lucky I am to be able to communicate with people all over the world, that our shared interest brings us together, letting me interact with people I'd otherwise never meet. Even in my own country, I can play other members of our community and apparently invite them to do a segment in this video, but instead they just talk about beating me. As I close this video out, I wanted to share one more story to offer perspective. Sometime after I moved to North Carolina, I was back in New York for a funeral and talking to a family member. He asked me what I liked so much about the state, and in addition to listing all the boring things that people normally care about, I mentioned how it was more conducive to board games. And he laughed at me, thinking it was lame and unimportant. He didn't understand how much this hobby means to me or those like me. I've been playing games my entire life. Much of that was spent looking for other players for these games, looking for people who shared my passion. Unless you are in the hobby, you don't have the opportunity to appreciate how it truly changes you. I could talk about how it refined my career in artificial intelligence, or how it inspires and nurtures my creativity. I could talk about how the hobby drives me to pursue my dreams. While that is true of the hobby in general, it is specifically true of the three favorite games I've mentioned today. But in Smash Up, I didn't just find something to unlock my passion and take it to new extremes. I found something much more important. I found people to share it with, who inspire me more than I could ever inspire them. And that's what I mean when I say that this game is special, and it means so much to me. Sorry, AEG, but this isn't your game anymore. It's ours. This is not a celebration just for AEG and the op, but for all of us. There were many others who wanted to be here today but couldn't, and I hope they get to be part of the channel soon. But I wanted to show my appreciation for the people who work hard to keep the game alive for us in the community. To Paul, Todd, Brian, Kelly, Mark, John, Jake, Fletch, just a handful of the many people I've worked with as I've gotten a glimpse of the industry. To every viewer, past, present, and future, every contributor, thank you for being part of what makes this milestone possible. In an industry where reprints are increasingly rare, let's celebrate the gravity of this milestone. Let me know what your favorite Smash Up moment was over the last 10 years. Let's fill the feed with comments, and if you haven't commented before, now is the time. It's been 10 years, and we still haven't shut it down.